Hello everybody, welcome back to Project Study Buddies. I'm Haley, and today we're going to talk about how to scam your workers to work more without paying them more. So, I'm sure that everyone is aware that work doesn't come for free. The most basic structure that we've been taught tells us that people need to be paid to be willing to complete work. Taylor's theory. No, not Taylor Swift. Another Taylor. But how true is that exactly? Let's put it this way. Money works, if you have it. And increasing salary works, until an increase in salary no longer benefits a worker. Look, if a raise means I could go from a dingy apartment to a condominium with a view of the skyline, of course I would put my hands to work, sign me right up. But if I've reached the point where I already live in a bungalow, then what's the point of more money? Well, we'll delve more into that in another video. For now, let's focus at the issue on hand. Say you're a small business owner. You really don't have the money to give anyone a pay rise. You have 3 workers here under your supervision. 2 are here just to earn a living. They don't like their jobs a lot. And the other is an intern. Why have I set these conditions? Because the way we motivate these workers will be very different. Our dear little intern here is definitely not here for the money. Look, we barely pay him enough to get lunch for the day. No, he's here because of passion, because he wants experience. Well, at least that's what he told us during his interview, how true that is now. So, the thing to note is that his intrinsic motivators are already very strong. He wants to work because he likes the work he's doing. He wants to work to learn more about the field. So, how do we make this person work more without paying him? Oh, it's all too easy. To answer this, we delve into the topic of job design. Before I go further, we need to understand the difference between task complexity and task variety. Complexity indicates the difficulty of a task. For example, when you can select the difficulty in a video game, be it beginner, medium, or expert. While variety indicates the different types of tasks within the same level of complexity. For example, in the video game again, once you select beginner, you can still choose, do you want theme 1, theme 2, etc. With that said, let's delve into the first solution. Job enlargement. When you hear about this, you definitely will be going, huh? Because frankly, it makes no sense. But it absolutely does. Remember how we talked about complexity and variety? Well, if our new intern here just joined, there's no way he can immediately do more difficult tasks. Give him some time to adapt, geez. But if we keep asking him to do the same things, then surely he'll start to get bored. And does boredom take a hit on motivation? So what do we do to curb his boredom? We give him more tasks within the same difficulty level. We change the variety of his task. He already knows how to answer calls, work the printer, and make a good cup of coffee. So now we introduce him to answering emails, working the fax machine, and buying lunch for everybody. He gets to feel like he's contributing more without feeling overwhelmed, and we get to have lunch without leaving the office. Next up, we have job enrichment. Now our little intern has been working here for about a week or two. He started to settle in and the menial tasks are starting to bore him. Not to mention, there's not really any more new tasks with the same complexity we can teach him. Guess it's finally time to take it up a notch and hit him with job enrichment. We give him more responsibility, more challenges, and make him feel like he just entered the company all over again. We start teaching him how to stock count, how to keep inventory, how to organize meeting schedules, the list goes on. The point is, now it's no longer about the variety, but about the complexity. By giving him more difficult tasks, he feels like he's learning because he's being challenged. And if done correctly, he's now working harder than ever, and you have even less work to do than previously. Number 3, job rotation. This one is a little out of the way. It's really more applicable for jobs where each person can only perform a single task at once. like, say, a factory environment where the workers are in a production line. Bob has to press the green button every 5 minutes. Sally puts the caps on bottles, and Malcolm seals the boxes. It's boring. But it's a production line, so they don't really have a choice but to stand there and do a task at a time. To prevent the boredom from building up too much, we use job rotation, which basically involves swapping tasks. For example, every 3 hours, they change stations. This helps curb boredom and ultimately helps with morale. Another example is perhaps in a fire station, where some firefighters get to go out on the field and some have to stay in the station to take calls and to clean all the equipment. But maybe they would find it unfair, like, I want to go out to the field too, why do you get to do all the cool heroics while I sit here answering, ma'am, this is the 5th time you called about your cat. Maybe calm down on letting her out? It's unfair. So what we do is perhaps every week or every other day, we swap tasks, we swap roles. That basically sums up the methods we use in job design. Now, earlier I said that these work on the intern, but that doesn't mean that it wouldn't work on the other two. It's just that they would work way better on the intern because the intern likes the work he's doing, and so his desires to learn and be useful are fulfilled by these methods. The other two, on the other hand, would only benefit by feeling less bored since they don't care much for their jobs. In essence, these methods work best on people who want to improve in their job and truly enjoy working the career. With that said, how do we go about getting these two to work harder then? Surely there are ways for them as well. Of course, we have non-financial motivators. In short, we increase their benefits in other ways. Number one, fringe benefits. Throw a company car into the mix, one they only get to keep if they keep producing good results, or give them free healthcare and insurance. These two without the prior conditions, because that seems a little immoral. They'll feel appreciated by the company, or at the very least, like they owe us something. After all, salary is a given, it's expected, thanks to Mr. Taylor over there. But other benefits aren't, so they'll feel a little special when they get offered all that. Now you must be thinking, well, that still entails spending money. What you have to understand is that on a financial statement, throwing a little bit of accounting in here, a company car will be stated as a non-current asset. Salary will be stated as an expense. In other words, the car is still ours, it's just that someone else is driving it. Once we pay an employee their wages, however, we aren't seeing that money again. Number two, employee discounts and store credit. Now this one is a real kicker. Not only do we motivate them to work more, but we also get them to spend money on us. Ah, the true evil of corporate greed. No, we don't give them our products for free. We aren't rich like that, but we do give them a 20% discount, which the sales team will know that we still make a 30% profit off of, but everyone else knows no better. Again, they feel appreciated, like they owe us something, and they work harder. They might even buy a few of our products and help us pay their salary. Store credit works almost the same way. You could be a good boss and give them store credit regardless. Or you could be like most other bosses and give them store credit only if they hit a target, be it sales, numbers of deals closed, or numbers of hours worked. This definitely motivates them in a more direct way. If they do good work, they get free things. Obviously, these tricks will also work on the intern, but they are definitely less of a scam, even if it's only marginally. We are here to save every penny we have. So, dear intern, you can stick with the mind games. And that's all on the topic. Please note that I do not endorse this in place of a livable wage. If any of you plan to become business owners, pay your employees well before you start on any of these tricks. But in the case of our business textbooks, it's safe to say that they aren't trying to teach us to be the most ethical boss out there. That's all I have for today. Remember to subscribe to our channel, visit our Discord and Instagram, all the links will be down in the description, and have fun studying. Thank you and bye-bye.